God is good. God is good. And I'm delighted to come before you this evening and share with you what God has given me. I want to thank God because he is so good. He's so merciful. He's just everything that I need. And the most important thing is that he's just a prayer away. I can call on him anytime, morning, noon, or night. And I know that my God will hear me. And not only will my God hear me, he will respond to me. Amen. So I think I got kind of a long lesson tonight, I think. So we're going to go ahead and get started. And we'll start with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day thus far. We thank you, Lord God, for your goodness, for your mercy, for your grace, for your loving kindness. Lord God, we thank you for all that you've done this day, Lord God, and all that you plan on doing in our lives, Lord God. We give you the honor. We give you the glory. We pray that you be with us on this night, Lord God, that you'll allow me to say what it is that you would have me to say, Lord God, and you'll bless those, Lord God, that are under the sound of my voice. Lord God, that you'll open up hearts, that you'll open up understanding, Lord God, so that we may hear, Lord God, and then adhere to your word. We pray this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen and amen. All right, so what I have for you tonight is really a question, but if you can see the title or topic is tethered to God. Tethered to God. And so my first question to you would be, what are you tethered to? I know I'm tethered to God. I need to be tethered to God. And if you don't understand exactly what that means, that's an old term. I think I'm showing my age. I think that's a old term, to be tethered to something. But let me give you the definition of what that means. So tether, as defined by the dictionary, is a line to which someone or something is attached in order to restrict movement. That's one definition. That's A. B is, it's a line. It's also defined as a line to which someone or something is attached to for security. Amen. So when I thought about that, then like I said, the question becomes, what are you tethered to? Are you tethered to something for security, or are you tethered to something that restricts your movement, that keeps you bound up in ways that's not healthy for you, that's not good for you? Amen. So we know there's only two types of yokes that we can be tethered to, and one is the yoke of bondage, and the other is the yoke of God. And so that's what I'm going to talk about tonight, is being tethered to God. And if you're not tethered to God, then what is necessary in order to get you in that position? Amen. So when we look at that, those definitions that I just gave about being tethered, what tethered means or how it's defined, when we look at this from a spiritual perspective, we definitely want to apply the second definition. We want to be attached to something for security. We know that in God, we are secure. In God, we have a hope, and that hope is in Christ Jesus, and that comes as we're tethered to him. So we know that it's God's desire that every yoke of sin, self, and man, every single weight in our life be broken. That's Bible. It's God's desire that we take his yoke upon us, and that we become untethered to those other yokes that keep us restricted, that limits our movement, that doesn't allow us to be tethered to him. He wants us to be yoked to him or tethered to him, because in him we have our security. He's our protection, and he's the hope for our salvation. Amen. So those are all wonderful reasons to want to be tethered to God. Amen. So it's necessary. It's necessary for us to see his vision properly, if we're not tethered to God, then we're not seeing through his perspective. We're not seeing the vision spiritually the way that he would have us to see it. Some of us are so restricted in our bondage that we can't see his vision at all. Amen. But it's important that we become tethered to him so that we can see his vision, not only for ourselves, but for the world, the vision that he has of the world. We need to be able to see that. Why? So that we can fulfill that vision, so that we can participate in his plan. Amen. Amen. So before I talk about the tethering that Jesus invites us to take hold of, let me explain some of those bonds, a little bit about the various bonds, yokes of bondage that needs to be destroyed in our life before we can become tethered to God. And so the various ways that we are tethered to can restrict our movements toward God and in God. Sometimes we can't get to him, and sometimes we're in him and we pick up certain things and they become a weight. They become yokes that we can't get rid of. And so therefore we can't be tethered to God in the manner that he would have us to be tethered to him. So just know that we're all under a yoke of some type. You're either tethered to the yoke of bondage or you are under the yoke of God. So the yoke of bondage, though, comes in different forms and different shapes and different ways. And the three main ones is the bondage to sin, the bondage to self, or the bondage to man. So I want to explain those three types of bondages to you before we move on into being tethered to God and what that means. So we'll look first at the yoke of sin. So in the Bible, when you read the various accounts, we understand that Egypt is a representative of the world or a representative of sin. And we know that we've been told to come out of sin so that we can reign in peace with God. And so we must have the yoke of sin broken in our lives if we're to come under the yoke of God. So the Bible tells us, this is in Leviticus 26 and 13, it says, I am the Lord your God, which brought you forth out of the land of Egypt, that ye should be not their bondmen, and I have broken the bonds of your yoke and made you go upright. So you know that the Israelites, after years and years and years upon years of being in bondage, that they wanted to be delivered. And we know that God did deliver them. They were restricted in their movements. They were bound. They couldn't worship God the way they wanted to worship God. They couldn't do the things that they needed to do because they were in a restrictive. They were bound by the Egyptians. But we know that God delivered them. And so we want to be delivered out of our restrictions so that we can be free to serve God. Amen. So the second one is the yoke of self. And that's the yoke of bondage that Apostle Paul speaks of. And he made it very clear that being tethered to our flesh causes us to do things that if we were tethered to God, we would never do. We wouldn't do some of the things that we do if we were tethered to God the way we're supposed to do. He says in Romans chapter 7, verse 15, for that which I do, I allow not. For what I would, that I do not. But what I hate, that do I. And so we find ourselves in those situations all the time. Our flesh is weak. The flesh wants what it wants. And so we find ourselves being tethered to it and not being able to manage it because we're not tethered to God. Amen. So we allow our flesh to have rule over us. And so some examples of that is selfishness and pride. They're examples of the yoke of self when we're being enslaved to our self nature. That's what I was just talking about. We're enslaved to our self nature, never or rarely being able to tell it no. Whatever the flesh wants, that's what we feed it. Wherever it wants to go, that's where we go. Whatever it wants to do, that's what we do. Oh, that's a bad place to be in. Allowing flesh to manage our actions and our thoughts. That way we cannot be tethered to God when we're allowing our flesh to have control over us. So that's the second one. The third one is the yoke of men. And we can go back and we can look at the Israelites again, because the Egyptians definitely had dominion, or they dominated the children of Israel. And that's what this yoke of men, that bondage of men is all about. When you think about the yoke of men and what it can include, the things like guilt and how men will guilt you into doing certain things, and we get bound by our tradition and we get bound in our denominations, so much so that whether it's right, wrong, whether it's taught in error, that we're so bound to it that we can't see our way out of it. And Jesus talks about that. I was talking about the Israelites and how they were bound under the influence of the Egyptians and were restricted in their movements. But then we think also that it didn't have anything to do with religion. But in Matthew 23:4, Jesus said, "For they bind heavy burdens and grievous to be borne and lay them on men's shoulders." And he's talking about the Pharisees back in that day. They burdened the people with all types of rules and all types of regulations. And the sad thing is, even though they bound the people with these rules and regulations and all these strenuous and tedious tasks, they themselves did not do it. And that's what Jesus was talking about in Matthew 23:24. We get caught up in impossible standards of behavior that's imposed by others of the world. That's bondage to man. We allow man to direct our thoughts and our actions rather than God. Those are three different types of bondages that will get you so tangled and tied up that you can't find your way to God, or you can't get yourself tethered to God, because you're all caught up in one of those three types of bondages. Amen. So I call it the threefold yoke of bondage, and that is of sin and self. And man speaks of imposed labor. It speaks of heaviness, and it speaks of restlessness. Amen. And we know that laying down by these types of various yokes make it impossible to take Jesus's yoke. We can't, because we're too tethered to something else. And he's already let us know that we can't serve two masters. We can't. I'll tell you this, and if you've lived long enough and you've had enough experiences, then you'll know that if you're trying to serve two masters, one's going to be underserved. There's no way around it. One's going to be underserved. Probably both are being underserved, because you cannot serve two masters equally. And the other part of that is, we know that God requires our all. And so if you're giving 10% over here to this and 30% over there to that, then how does that equal up to the 100% that God requires of us? Amen. So we can't do it. But I'm here to tell you tonight that the good news is that God has the power to break every tether that restricts us in fulfilling our God-given purpose. The power is found in God. Amen. He will do it. I just love it. Zechariah, when he says, "Not by power, not by might, but by my spirit." Amen. He's able to do everything. He's able to do what we call the impossible. He's able to make it possible. Amen. So in the Old Testament account, Israel was surrounded by the enemy army of the Assyrians. The Assyrians and was constantly after the Israelites. But God spoke to Israel in the book of Isaiah, and he declared unto them, "The Lord of hosts have sworn, saying, surely as I have thought, so shall it come to pass, and as I have purposed, so shall it stand, that I will break the Assyrian in my land, and upon my mountains tread him underfoot. Then shall his yoke depart from off them and his burden departing off of their shoulders. That's Isaiah 14, 24 through 25. God's plan was to break the yoke from off the neck of Israel. That was his plan. And then we see a few chapters later is recorded that the angel of the Lord went forth and smote in the camp of the Assyrians 185,000. And when they arose early in the morning, behold, they were all dead corpses. All of them were killed. That's Isaiah 37 and 36. And so I'm here to tell you tonight that just as God did it then, he can do the same today. He can break every single yoke, every single thing that's hindering you, every single thing that's keeping you away from him. He can break that. But we have to allow him to do the work. We have to give him a yes in order for him to do the work that he needs to do in our life. God wants to break every yoke in our life. He wants it to become as a dead corpse. He wants to destroy it in order to bring you under his yoke. Has to be destroyed. We already said you cannot serve two masters. And so we know, as the Bible tells us, that it's only through the power of God that we become untethered to the yokes of bondage. It's only through the power of God. Let me tell you, it won't be destroyed by smooth talking, snazzy preaching. It won't be destroyed by educational degrees. Let me tell you, that's emotionalism and it's intellectualism. But I already told you, it's the Spirit of God that breaks the yoke. Amen. So know that it won't be destroyed through organizations or denominations or sects or cultural beliefs or through tradition. It can only be destroyed by the anointing of the Holy Spirit, which is the power of God. Amen. Isaiah says it like this. He says, and the yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing. The anointing of what? The anointing of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We have to have that anointing. Ah, but just like the Israelites, God's purpose for breaking the yoke, it extends beyond our life. He wants to break the yoke of bondage in our life to enable us to fulfill his vision. God's got a vision that's going to be fulfilled, whether you participate in it or not, but he wants your participation. His will is that you participate in his plan. Amen. The plan that he has not only for your life, but the plan that he has for the world. Amen. So we find this. I'm not just telling you what I think. I tell you what I read in the Bible. And so we find in Isaiah 14 verses 26 through 27, it says, this is the purpose that is purposed upon the whole earth. Excuse me. And this is the hand that is stretched out upon all the nations. For the Lord of hosts have purposed, and who shall disannul it? And his hand is stretched out, and who shall turn it back? He has a plan for the world, not just for you and us, you and I individually, but you and I corporately, including the entire world. So God tells us there's some things that we need to do, such as to lose the bonds of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, and to let the oppressed go free, and that you break every yoke. Amen. Break it, become untethered to it, and then destroy it. Amen. So you can be tethered with God. So you should know that the yokes are broken for a purpose. They're not broken just for the sake of being broken. The results of the breaking of the yokes of bondage are so that we will know the voice of God. Amen. I heard the song, I hear you clearly. We need to be able to hear God clearly. We need to be able to call on him and know that he will respond. Amen. Breaking the yokes means that we will be successful in the fulfillment of God's vision. Our light will rise in obscurity, which speaks of success. This is not just God's vision. This is our vision within God's vision. That vision will be successful. When the yokes are broken, we know that we have an assurance that God will guide us continually. He will be our provision. Amen. Everything that we need, we can find in Christ Jesus. Whatever it is that we need, we know that it is provided through Christ Jesus. Amen. Not only that, we will be reproductive. And I'm not talking about reproductive in terms of being in labor, of having children, but we'll be reproductive in the earth. In other words, we will produce more souls. We will help to bring more souls to Christ. Amen. That's part of his plan. He calls us laborers in his harvest field. Amen. And he tells us that the harvest is plenteous. And so we laborers are needed to help produce. Amen. So we'll be like a watered garden, which is fruitful. And those we produce in the spirit world will also be reproductive. And they will rise up to rebuild the old structures on the right foundation, because we've reproduced them spiritually in the right way. And this is not just me talking. This is straight from the Bible. You can read that in Isaiah 58, verses 9 through 12. Just know that when the yoke is broken, we are no longer tethered to it. That's why it's so necessary to break every single yoke of bondage that's in our life. Break every single weight that is in our life. Amen. Break it, destroy it. God promised Israel in the natural world, he says in Ezekiel 34 through 27, and the tree of the field shall yield her fruit, and the earth shall yield her increase, and they shall be safe in their land, and shall know that I am the Lord when I have broken the bonds of their yoke. The same is true. This was a natural application, but the same is true in the spirit world. The breaking of the yoke results in spiritual productivity. That's what I was just telling you about. But what we have to understand is that the old way, the way we try to do things in our own strength, is inadequate. It won't work. It won't work. The old way is inadequate, and it's broken, and it's empty. And when I say the old way, I'm referring to the old man, how the old man handled it. The old man is the man that was before Christ entered our lives, before we were filled with his Holy Ghost and got a new way. And so the new way refers to God's way. So we can handle it in the old man. We can handle our spiritual business and any other business for that matter in the old man. We have to take on the new. So the old can't accommodate the abundant harvest that God sees. It has to be done in the new. So new foundations and new strategies, a new way is necessary in order to bridge the gap between sinful man and a righteous God. Can't get to God through the old man. Have to come in through the new man. Amen. That one that's got the new way, that one that's filled with the Spirit of God. And so the vision will only be fulfilled by men and women who have experienced the anointing of the infilling of the Holy Spirit. Without the Holy Spirit, we are just beings with good intentions and only partially successful efforts. And we're going to talk about that later on. Only partial successful efforts. It's not enough. That's the good intentions. It's just not enough. So then you may ask yourself, how do we break the yoke so that we can become what God has called us to be? Well, the Bible tells us to let go of every weight, every single weight and sin yoke that tethers us, and grab hold of the yoke that God offers us. He tells us in his word in Matthew 11, 28 and through 30, he says, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and I'm lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." Won't be anything like the children of Israel under bondage to Israel. Their way was hard. Their days were hard. They were beaten. Well, they didn't do things the way the Israelites thought that they needed to do it. But God said, "Come unto me. My yoke is easy and my burden is light." So it's God's desire to bring you to an expected end. And it's his expected end, not yours. We have to lay aside all of our old ways and our old thoughts and tether ourselves to God and then take on his vision and his plan for our lives. That expected end that God talks about in Jeremiah 29 and 11, that says, "For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end." Amen. But that expected end is fulfillment of the vision, finishing the work of God. Just as Jesus said, he said it in John 4 and 34. He said, "My meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work." Amen. That should be all of our desire. It should be all of our endeavors to do the will of God, and whatever assignment or purpose that he has placed upon our life, that is what we should be endeavoring to do. Amen. Amen. And just know that he will be with you all along the way. He will provide for you. He will give you that which you need to fulfill the purpose that he's placed in your life. Amen. Amen. So, how can I, the question, because how can I, when I'm tethered to something else, I want to do the will of God. I want to be obedient. I want to, but how can I do this when I'm tethered to something else? Well, whenever you enter into something new, it always requires leaving the old. So you've got to leave the old behind and take a step of faith. God tells us this. He tells us that he doesn't want us to cling to the events of the past, the things of the past, or dwell on what's happening, what happened long ago. You leave all that behind as you press forward. Amen. Read Isaiah 43 and 18, where he says, "Watch for the new thing." The thing that he's going to do is happening already. So that means it's happening. That means it's current and it's going on in the future. Doesn't have anything to do with the past. It's a new thing. So look for it. Be ready for it. Be prepared for it. Amen. Amen. But the sad thing is, even as we ask that question, is that unfortunately we are so intent on the old that we can't always see or accept the new. But we have to let it go. We have to let go of every single thing, every single yoke that we're tethered to that prevents us from moving forward and that has us bound to the past, bound to our sins, which is our flesh, bound to man. Well, I don't want to disappoint him. I don't want to disappoint her. They did this for me, so I have to do that for. No. Mm-mm. Take that step of faith. Take that first step of faith and move towards God and see what he has for you. Amen. We have to let it go. Those things that we're tethered to, those things that prevents us from moving forward, those things that have us bound. Just think about all the different things that we're bound to. Some may be bound by doctrine, the doctrine that claims the power of God is no longer for today. Some people preach that, but once you've been washed in the blood and filled with the precious Holy Ghost, we know that the power, that same power that existed yesterday in the beginning is the same power that exists today. And that power is through God. Amen. Some people may think that the extension of the gospel, the spreading of the word of God is the responsibility of just the ministers or the preachers. So they won't do that corporate assignment that God has given all his children to spread the word of God, because they're stuck in something that they've been told. Some may be bound by tradition or by denominations which prevent you from joining hands with the rest of the body of Christ in the harvest fields of the Lord. Amen. Who told you that self-righteousness to make you think that you're the only one that's right? You're the only one that got it together, so nobody can do this but you. No, no, no. Mm-mm. We are the body of Christ. Amen. Amen. So we get caught up though in these types of thoughts and these types of actions, and these things they tether us and keep us restricted from moving forward in God. But I'm here to tell you that whatever yoke of bondage that we're tethered to, it must be destroyed, because in God we have that new vision. God's got a vision that's different from your vision. And so we don't see things the way that we used to see them. We now see them the way God wants us to see them, through spiritual eyes. Amen. And not through a carnal mind. And so we have to become a part of this new network of spiritual laborers bound together by unity of purpose. And that purpose is a God-driven purpose. It's a purpose that's given to us by God, not by man. But through his word, he lets us know what it is that should be done. It's through his word that we see the vision that we have, that we should be performing according to his word. Amen. So this is something that I ran across in my Bible studies, and I just want to share this with you, because I thought it really fit into what I'm talking about as far as letting go of the old and embracing the new. So there's two separate incidents. I believe I heard Pastor Tim talk about one of them a couple of weeks ago, and that's involving the use of a net when you're fishing. And this was an account in the natural world, when a parable is something that actually happened, but it illustrates a spiritual truth. And so one speaks of letting go of the old, and the other speaks of embracing the new. Amen. Or accepting the new. And so they're both fishing accounts. And so the first event occurred at the beginning of Christ's earthly ministry. And this one is recorded in Luke chapter 5. So the account, I'm not going to read the whole thing. I'll just kind of give you the overview of it. The disciples had been fishing all night long and had caught nothing. And then Jesus came to them and he told them to launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a draught. Even though they had been fishing all night long and had not caught anything, he tells them nevertheless to let down their nets. Launch out into the deep and let down your nets. And then the Bible goes on to say that Peter replied and said, "Master, we have toiled all the night and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net." That's Luke 5 and 5. And for me, with my imagination, I can just hear Peter thinking to himself, "I let go of my knowledge and my experience and expertise as a fisherman, and I'm going to be obedient to the men of God." And we know that they did that. And so when they let down the net, The Bible tells us that they caught so many fish that it broke, and they had to call their partners in another boat to come and help them. And the catch was so great that it filled both boats, and they began to sink. And even though they caught fish, it says that the net broke and the boats began to sink. And Peter was amazed at this, but Jesus took this opportunity to share with him, to give him some insight how this was parallel to Peter's life. And he told him, "Fear not, from henceforth thou shalt catch men." But it wasn't Peter's time yet. Peter was not yet prepared to be that great fisher of men. Not yet. And so the catch Peter was experiencing in the natural world was nothing. This is what Jesus was trying to tell him, was nothing compared to the great harvest he would reap in the spirit world as he became a fisher of men. Amen. So, but that's not the gist of what I want you to get here. There is a similar incident that's recorded after Christ mortal, I'm saying mortal, when he still walked the earth as a man. And so this occurred after his mortal ministry had ended. And this account is recorded in John chapter 21. And in this case, the disciples had fished all night, just like the last time, and had caught nothing. But at Christ's command, they cast in the net, and once again, it was filled with fish. I'm sure there's probably no hesitation this time when he said, cast the net, probably cast it with no hesitation. He said, cast it, some will cast it. They did. But this time, and when they cast it, it was filled with fish just like the last time. But this time was different from the first. The net didn't break. If you noticed in the first account, it said they caught so many fish, they had to call their partners over. And even at that, the boat began to sink and the net broke. But this time, they caught fish, but the net did not break. And so we find in John 21 and 11, this is what it says specifically. Simon Peter went up and drew the net to land full of great fishes, 153, and for all there were so many, yet was the net not broken, as if they expected the net to break, but it didn't. So these two events, they actually happen. These are not parables. These are actual occurrences, but they were parallels of a spiritual truth. The first time the net broke, but the second time it did not. And so what made the difference? Both times they caught a great amount of fish. The first time the nets broke, the second time they didn't. So here we go. The first net was an example of the efforts of man. Peter, as described in the Bible, was a fisherman by trade. So he knew the natural methods and he knew the tradition of fishermen. And so Jesus shows that the efforts of man alone cannot fulfill the vision and work of God. It takes more than just our efforts. We have to have something different. And so when Peter realized that the great work to which God was calling him, which was that he was going to be a great fisherman of men, he cried out, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man." Peter realized that on his own, he couldn't do it. He couldn't do it. He knew that he was tethered to some things that would prevent him from doing the work of God. And so again, I can just hear him with my vivid imagination. I can hear him thinking, "I'm still attached to the old man. I'm tethered to cultural beliefs," which we know he was, because God had to show him the right way, and there are things, there's some cultural beliefs that are not God-driven, and there were yokes in Peter's life that needed to be broken. He was dealing with some things that he was tethered to, but in order to be that great fisher of men, he had to become untethered to those things. So Peter would, we know as the Bible tells us, go on to become a great fisher of men, but the old way could not accommodate the great spiritual harvest. Peter would have to abandon the traditions of man and his cultural beliefs. He had to cross the line of separation between Jews and Gentiles. That was part of his cultural beliefs, but he had to let that go. The old way had to be broken in order for him to become a part of the new network that Jesus was establishing, in order for him to become a part of the better way. Amen. And so this second incident was totally different in that a new way had been established. The work of the cross had been completed. And so God opened up the new way through the crucifixion of God, of Jesus on the cross. And that work had been completed when he met up on the second fishing expedition. And so Jesus was now talking to them in his resurrected state. He's in a new way now. He's not coming to them as a mortal man now. He's in his new resurrected body. And so this lets me know that our old efforts didn't work, or at best they was only partially successful. But now, fueled with the power of the Holy Spirit, all things are possible through Christ. It was the filling of the Holy Spirit that allowed the yokes to be broke in the life of Peter, that destroyed the yokes in the life of Peter so that he could go on to become what Jesus told him that he would be. Amen. So Jesus, just know this, Jesus did not come to destroy the old, but to fulfill it through the new. He did not destroy the law, but he added new meaning to it. He did not abolish the blood sacrifice for sin, but he fulfilled it through the shedding of his own blood. And we thank God for that, that shedding of his blood for the remission of sins. Amen. That gives us the power now. He told us that he was going to send back the Comforter, the Holy Ghost, that we would be endued or filled with power. And that power we know is the Holy Spirit. Amen. And the Holy Spirit is like a domino effect. That Holy Spirit gives us the power to break the yokes that so easily come upon us, that we get entangled or tethered to. The power of the Holy Ghost can lead us, can guide us away from things that we see coming our way. Sometimes we don't even see them, but with the power of the Holy Ghost leading us and guiding us, we escape things. We're secure through the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. So Jesus warned us about putting new wine into old wineskins. That's in the Bible. The old wineskins would not be able to hold the new wine, just as the net, that old system could not hold the fish in that first boating expedition. And so the challenge to fulfill God's plan cannot be accomplished with anything less than a new way, which is in the Spirit. Amen. That's the only way. So between the first and the second fishing trips, a new way had been created. That first fishing trip, Jesus was still on the earth doing his ministry. The new way had not yet been created. These natural fishing incidents were parallels of what had happened in the spiritual world. Amen. In the spirit world. And so the old yoke must be broken. The old yoke must be destroyed. Must be destroyed in order for the new way to take hold. Amen. God, he that never leaves us lacking or wanting. I just love it when he knew. He knew that on our own, we would never be able to make it. He told the disciples in several different places, oh, that when I leave, I got to send you back something to help you. Because you can't do it on your own. You can't make it on your own. Your best intentions, your best desires, they're good and they're wonderful, but you cannot do it without my Spirit residing within you. We need the Spirit of the Holy Ghost. Amen. We need that power residing on the inside, that keeps us. It keeps us. Amen. Amen. So the old yoke, like I said, must be broken, has to be broken. And so the new way is what Jesus spoke about when he said, come unto me. Come unto me. All ye that labor and are heavy laden. Let me pause here and let me ask you, how are you tired of your sin? Are you tired of the weights that hold you down? Are you tired of being tethered to things that no longer even mean anything to you, but yet just because you're tethered to it, you can't seem to break away? But God says, come unto me. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let go of the old and take hold of the new. Learn of me, for I am meek and I'm lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Amen. That's Matthew 11, 28 through 30. This is what we need in order to be tethered to God. We need to take his yoke upon us. This yoke, when I gave you the definition and I told you of being tethered, when I told you the definition A talked about being restricted in movement. Well, we know that can't be the type of tethering that's of God, because God said that he came to set us free. He came to set us free. So it has to be the second one. I want to be tethered to God for security, for safety, to maintain my hope in salvation. That's why I want to be tethered to God. And so just like I gave you the threefold of yoke of bondage, the bondage of the yoke of sin, the yoke of self, and the yoke of man. Well, God has a threefold plan also, and it's all found within Matthew 11, 28 and 30, the verse that I just read to you. The yoke of God speaks of a united labor instead of an imposed labor, such as what the Egyptians did to the children of Israel. He invites you to come. He doesn't force you to come. He doesn't make you to come. I love what Pastor Tim said last night. I've said it for years. God is, he's not a rapist. He's not a seducer. He leads us according to, he allows us the freedom of our own free will. But he invites you. He encourages you. He doesn't lie to you. He doesn't try to seduce you. He doesn't try to deceive you. Oh, but that threefold yoke of God has within it every single thing that we need to be tethered to him. It's like I said, it's a united labor instead of an imposed labor. It speaks of lightness instead of heaviness. There's nothing worse than being weighted down by guilt and by shame. And if it's not that, just weighted down by the cares of the world and not being able to see or find your way out of situations. But it speaks of, God's yoke speaks of lightness instead of heaviness. And it's a yoke of rest instead of restlessness. The threefold yoke of God is easy, it's light, and it's restful. That's what I want to be tethered to. I can't speak for nobody else, but that's what I want to be tethered to. And so Jesus provides three steps to destroy the yoke of bondage that we're tethered to. It is the way out of the old and the way in to the new. Amen. So the first one, he says, come, come. He invites us to come. And so we must willingly come to him. Oh, that's the first step in destroying the yoke of sin, is to come willingly to God, to recognize that I can't do this thing on my own, that I need help. And I know that that help comes from above. Amen. And then secondly, he tells us to take. He says we must take his yoke and receive his gift of the Holy Spirit. And in doing so, the yoke of man is destroyed and we're no longer tethered to it, because now we're following God. And one of your thoughts or your saying or your intentions ought to be that if God didn't say it, I don't want no part of it. I'm following God now, and I'm being obedient to his word, not to your traditions, not to your thoughts, not to your guilt tactics, not to your lies and your deceit, but I'm listening to my God, because his yoke is easy and it's light and it's restful. Amen. And then lastly, he tells us to learn. And by learning of him, then we destroy the yoke of self as we apply his knowledge to our lives. And that's threefold: come, take, and learn. And so the yoke of God is not simply imparted by him. It is shared by him. His spirit is with us, leading us and guiding us all along the way. And so I want to encourage you today, this evening, everybody that's under the sound of my voice, to learn of God through his word. The Bible tells us that his word that is profitable for doctrine and for reproof and for correction and instruction in righteousness. Just learn it. Learn his word. It's good for you. That's 2 Timothy 3:16 through 17. Tether yourself to a good line, which in this case is God. Get tethered to God. Amen. It's the only thing that brings us spiritual success. And not only does it bring us spiritual success, but it's our security and it's our hope in Christ Jesus. Amen. Amen. So I certainly thank God for the word on tonight. I pray that something was said that encourages you, that enlightens you, and empowers you on your journey, either to Christ or in Christ, wherever state you may be in. Find yourself being tethered to God. Learn of him. Get to know him through his word and then through your experiences through him. And you will find that being tethered to God is the best thing that could ever happen to you in your life. Amen. So I certainly thank God for the word on tonight. I thank God. It taught me, even as I hope it taught you something about God and the benefits of being tethered to him. Amen. Knowing what he wants for us, the purpose that he has given us, and then giving us the power through his Holy Spirit to carry out that will. Amen. So I pray that everyone have a wonderful rest of your evening, that God continues to bless you and to watch over you, to keep you and to strengthen you. And so I want to say to everyone, God bless you and good night.